Hi, I'm JD, and welcome back to Comics Are Awesome, where we bring you everything awesome in comics. You know, growing up as a kid, I read a lot of Marvel comics, but I never really bought into the whole divide between Marvel and DC. I just liked to read what I wanted to read. Even today, I probably read a little bit more Marvel than anything else, and yet I still enjoy all types of comics from all different types of publishers. So, with that spirit in mind, we're going to take a look at one of DC Comics' marquee characters. With All-Star Superman by Grant Morrison and Frank Quietly. So who's the guy in the Angry Joe t-shirt? Spoiler warning! Let's talk about Superman. Superman is one of the most recognizable characters in the world. Whether it's the George Reeves TV series, Chris Reeves films, or the more recent animated series from Bruce Timm, or Smallville, or Lois and Clark, The New Adventures of Superman, The Adventures of Superboy, Superman Returns, Max Fleischer, Superman Cartoons, Superman Justice League, Super Friends, Superboy, and the Legion of Superheroes, Crypto, Superpup, and of course, there's video games, books, t-shirts! Anyways, the point is that even the people who have never picked up a comic in their life know who Superman is. A symbol of hope, morality, and the potential of the human spirit, and proudly displaying your underwear on the outside. Of course, a lot of people forget his true roots. During the Golden Age, Superman was a force for social justice, often taking on mobsters, corrupt politicians, slumlords, and the like. He couldn't fly, but rather leap. He was strong, but not quite lift up a mountain strong, but as time passed, his powers began to ramp up, and up. And by the 50s and 60s, Superman was pretty much all-powerful. Now keep in mind, this was before special effects were common in film or TV, so if you're a kid in the 60s, this was quite likely the closest you'd come to ever get to see someone lift a giant key to open a door to their bachelor pad in the Arctic. So the wow factor likely carried these stories for a lot of children, even if they might not seem that special by today's standards. Of course, this also had some drawbacks. Mainly, what do you do with a guy who is all-powerful? How do you make interesting stories around someone whose only weakness is a rare green rock?
Well, if you're DC Comics in the 50s and 60s, you kind of go batshit crazy.
I'm not even kidding. A lot of these stories in the Superman universe at the time were just flat-out weird. From my understanding, Mort Weisinger, the Superman editor at the time, would ask his neighbor's children what they would want to see Superman do next. But we didn't exactly get riveting tales of intrigue, but rather the type of stuff you'd expect young children to come up with. So you get stories where Lois became a witch, super gorillas, super babies, super Perry, Superman's ability to super promote gay pride? Or at least I think that's what's going on there. To be fair, a lot of these covers only loosely or not at all represent what's happening inside the actual story. But really, Superman of this era isn't typically remembered for solid writing, drama, and life-threatening perils as much as embracing being goofy. As time would go on, Superman became a bit more grounded again. This is most notable in the mid-80s reboot of Superman, starting with Superman Man of Steel, which revamped his origins, focusing more on the Kent family who raised Clark, and the book brought his overall power level down to a more reasonable level. He's still Superman, but not quite as unbeatable as he once was. It also made Superman more human and approachable, someone who is just as amazing for his noble heart because of his upbringing, rather than simply being born better than humans. And while there would be tweaks to his origin here and there over the years, Man of Steel would serve as the basis for most Superman stories being told from this point on.
So that's it? The Silver Age was just a weird footnote in the long history of Superman? No, of course not. Why do you think I bring it up in a comic made in 2006?
All-Star Superman was part of the DC's aborted All-Star line of comics. The idea was to take iconic DC characters and give them a top-tier writers and artists that could tell stories not weighed down by years of continuity. This was an interesting idea in theory, but only two series managed to come out with the All-Star banner. All-Star Superman and All-Star Batman and Robin, the Boy Wonder.
Look, I'm the positive comic book review guy, but if you want to learn more about All-Star Batman and Robin, I defer you to link our own reviews of that series. Or to put it more succinctly,
these comics suck!
You have been warned.
All-Star Superman is, however, different. Very different. As in, crazy different. How so? Well, let's take a gander. The story begins with probably one of the most succinct and minimalistic retellings of Superman's origins ever. doomed planet. Desperate scientists. Last hope. Kindly couple.
Again, this plays on how iconic Superman is. We don't need a long history on how Krypton exploded and how he was discovered by the Kents. We already all know that. Instead, it takes all the great elements of Superman and refines it down to a slim and elegant package. Much like myself. Why are you laughing?
The actual story begins with a manned space shuttle taking a voyage to the sun.
Let me explain. No, let me not explain. While flying to the sun would probably be pressing the limits of implausibility in most comics or science fiction today, keep in mind that this is an homage to the Silver Age, where comic book science really didn't resemble science.
The mission is led by scientist Leo Quintum, but he isn't given much time to celebrate as one of the crew members start mutating and attacking the rest of the crew.
Are we there yet?
No.
Are we there yet?
No.
Are we there yet?
Look, you ask one more time, and I'm turning around and turning into a monster.
Are we there yet?
No, there's another mastermind behind this. Who could it be? Darkseid? Toy Man? Mr. Mixie Plicklick? Dom DeLuise?
Wrong!
No, of course, it's Lex Luthor, who created the crew member as a sleeper agent slash bomb inside the mission. But have no fear, Superman is on the way. Back on Earth, Lois Lane is already writing about how Superman has saved the day before it's even happened. Jimmy Olsen is helping Lois by giving her factoids from his Superwatch. As an aside, I love that Jimmy walks into the Daily Planet wearing a jetpack with no explanation and no one questioning it. Elsewhere, Lex is confronted by General Sam Lane, who demands to know what Lex thinks he's doing. Lex Luthor has been hired to design tech for the military with the promise that he wouldn't try to kill Superman. But clearly Lex had other plans, controlling the bomber remotely from Earth. Also, he plans to steal 40 cakes. And that's terrible. Superman reaches Quintum's ship and manages to eject the human bomb before he slash it goes off, but the ship is still in danger. But oddly enough, Superman begins to emit a bioelectric field from his body that lets him shield the ship and safely get it away from the sun. Apparently, Superman has developed a new superpower.
I suppose that's marginally more useful than super ventriloquism.
At Quintum's laboratory on the moon, God, that's just fun to say. Superman is lifting 200 quintillion tons one-handed. Quintum realized that since Superman gets his powers from our yellow sun, that flying into the sun like he did has supercharged Superman's solar batteries. Try saying that three times fast. Resulting in the biofield as well as a sharp increase in strength and possibly other effects. But it comes at a steep cost. It's not merely just a power boost for the Man of Steel, but rather the sun has overloaded Superman's cells. In effect, Superman is now slowly dying. The first issue closes with General Lane arresting Luthor, and Clark helps Lois home before he opens up his shirt, revealing that he is Superman.
Just a moment. Clark Kent is Superman.
This and the following 11 issues are simply remarkable. Almost all of them are standalone stories, meaning that for the most part, they can be read with no knowledge of what has happened before in the previous issue. There is one two-part story involving Bizarro, but that's the exception, which in an age where comics are typically written for the trade, it's really refreshing to see a book where you can read a chapter of it and feel like you've got a satisfying story out of it. But there's also a through line in the comic with Superman basically coming to terms with his impending death. The way it's portrayed is very subtle. He doesn't fret, he doesn't bargain, or get angry. This is a man who's faced thousands of threats, some of them even a danger to him. So I get the impression he always knew something like this might happen, and has more or less accepted his fate, and has chosen to make the best of the time he has left. Which is really true of Superman's trail here as a whole. Go pick up some recent Superman comics. I guarantee you'll find lots of portrayals with his arms crossed, or chest puffed out, or floating above people and looking down on them. This is a different portrayal. This is a Superman who, for the most part, doesn't worry or feel threatened, and has no reason to act tough. He's freaking Superman. Whether it's Superman giving Lois superpowers for 24 hours, or Jimmy Olsen having to fight off a Superman corrupted by black kryptonite, or a young Superman encountering several other Supermen from the future, Grant Morrison's stories all have a weird vibe of the classic Silver Age tales, but with better storytelling and more genuine heart. There are moments here that sincerely tugged on my heartstrings. Morrison is partnered with Frank Quitely for the art in this series. Quitely, a frequent partner of Morrison's, seems to be a love-him-or-hate-him artist. The big complaint from non-fans is he tends to draw somewhat lumpy-looking people, particularly his men. They don't tend to have clean, simple line work that many of the other artists have. And to be fair, that was my initial reaction when I first saw his art as well. But what's harder to argue is how he's an excellent storyteller. A good artist tells the story as much or more than the writer's words, and Quitely is one of the best in that regard. The art always flows smoothly from panel to panel. You never get confused as to how to read a page, and the characters are all very expressive. One of the parts I like best is how he portrays Clark Kent. Clark slouches and wears bad-fitting suits. It's no wonder no one thinks he's Superman. He looks like he's at least 40 pounds heavier. This is one of the few times I've ever thought that the difference between Clark and Superman was pronounced enough to believe it as a secret identity. It's touches like these which mark Quitely as one of the superstar pencilers of the comic world, with or without potato-faced characters.
I think I'd be remiss without mentioning the recent direct-to-DVD adaptation of All-Star Superman.
Bells are breaking down. Produced by Bruce Timm, who did the Batman, Superman, and Justice League cartoons, with a script adapted by the late Julian McDuffie, a noteworthy comic writer in his own right, this is an excellent translation of the material, and while it inevitably cuts some bits out, what remains is very loyal to the original comic. Definitely worth checking out.
So there you have it, folks. While there might be more action-packed Superman comics out there, I've never read one that has a better understanding of what makes Superman great than these two trades. Go out and give it a shot, or I'll send Angry Joe after you. And remember, comics are awesome, and we're gonna get the word out.
I wish that I could cry, fall upon my knees, find a way to lie about a home I'll never see. It may sound absurd, but don't be